We spend the rest of the hour with Reverend Dr. William Barber, co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, president of Repairers of the Breach, joining us from Raleigh, North Carolina. Can you talk about the framing of not only the vice presidential debate, but the presidential debates? Not only that, what these candidates are willing to talk about when it comes to issues of poverty? I don't know if that word was mentioned even once last night, and other economic crises that people are facing, Dr. Barber.
You know, one of the things that continues to bother us, and the way in which the moderators don't even bring up an issue that before COVID-19 was impacting 43% of this nation, 140 million people before COVID were poor and low wealth, and 62 million people working for less than a living wage. And since COVID, we know that millions have been added to the poverty and low wealth numbers. We were well over 50% because of the new poor. We know we had 87 million people before COVID that were either uninsured or underinsured, and now some 20 million people have been added because of people who've lost their insurance because they've lost their jobs. 40% of the jobs that make $40,000 a year have been lost, and the framing. It's amazing that we can't start there. I think Senator Harris did a tremendous job in pointing out the economic injustice. But one of the things I would say is we have to stop saying things were well before COVID. It's almost as though we give that away to the Trump and Pence. The reality is Wall Street was well. The reality is those who got his tax cuts were well. The reality is, though, that before COVID, they were trying to overturn health care. Before COVID, they were blocking living wages. Before COVID, we were not addressing the issue of poor and low-wealth people. And we have to find a way to say that. I wish the moderators would just talk about that and open it up, Amy, because 64 million poor and low-wealth people were eligible to vote in the last election. That's more, nearly one-third of the electorate. 34 million did not vote. And a study that we just recently did called Power Unleashed, Unleashing the Power of Poor and Low-Wealth Voters, it said that the number one reason that poor and low-wealth people did not vote is actually was a tri-reason. They never hear their names called, their issues, the lack of transportation, and they can't get off a job, and voter suppression. But that's the very group that in 15 states, if just 1 to 20% of them vote, Michigan 1%, North Carolina 19%, Florida 7%, could fundamentally shift the electorate. And they deserve to no longer be marginalized, but to be heard and to be talked about in these debates.
Reverend Barber, I'd like to ask you about one aspect of what this widespread poverty before the pandemic and after the pandemic has induced, namely food insecurity. According to the Census Bureau and the Department of Agriculture, the level of hunger in U.S. households has tripled since 2019, and the proportion of American children who sometimes don't have enough to eat is now as much as 14 times higher than last year. So could you talk about that particular issue and your assessment of the Biden-Harris plan, their anti-poverty proposal?
Well, you know, when Pence talked last night, he told what my grandmother called a bold-faced lie. The first CARES Act, 83% of the money went to corporations and banks. It did not go to the people. And when we look at COVID-19, we know that the fissures of systemic racism and systemic poverty have actually allowed this pandemic to have a greater hold in our American society. We know that when we talk about death, we have to disaggregate that. It's not just people are dying, poor people are dying. People who make less than $50,000 a year are dying. Among people are dying who are among the poor, whether it be white, black, and disproportionately among black and brown, and indigenous people. And that COVID has killed more people in the U.S. than Americans were killed in battle in five of our most recent wars, Korea, Vietnam, Iraq, the war in Afghanistan, and the Persian Gulf War. I mean, this is what we're talking about. And we're talking about this devastation that's happening among poor and low-wealth people. And then we're talking about the residual, the other impacts. For instance, 13 million people, one study says that we did, who make under $50,000 a year, one in five don't know where they're going to get their next food. They don't know how they're going to eat. Millions, upwards of 40 million people are facing eviction. One of the things I like about the fact of the Biden-Harris plan is that they are, number one, not talking about taking people's health care. The Trump-Pence plan, that's what they're saying. We elect us, we'll take your health care. The Biden-Harris plan is talking about raising people's living wage to $15 an hour. The Trump-Pence plan is talking about giving more money to the wealthy. In fact, the Trump-Pence-McConnell plan, they refused to pass the stimulus because they want another $200 billion in tax cuts. They want money for a fighter jet, and they want to protect corporations from liability when those corporations didn't protect their people from coronavirus. So what we have is two different worlds operating. Pence, with a straight face, lying, basically said, vote for us, and we'll take your health care and undermine your pre-existing condition. Vote for us, and we'll block living wages. Vote for us, we will not protect the environment. Vote for us, and we'll put people on the Supreme Court who will be against your health care, against labor rights. You know, one of the things people forget about this nominee is that she voted against people getting overtime pay. And so we're living in two different worlds. Not only will Pence and Trump not acknowledge racism when it comes to police violence, they're not even acknowledging the disparate racism in economics and in healthcare and so forth and so on. So on the one hand, while Biden and Harris may not be every fully where the Poor People's Campaign are, they're in the world of wanting to do more. They're in the sphere of wanting to increase. They're in the sphere of wanting to make sure that the people have what they need, as opposed to wanting to only secure the wealthy and the greedy. And it's tragic. And to think that someone running for the vice president, you're talking about disrespecting people. Number one, not only to lie to them, but to be so bold that you literally look people in the eye and say, in essence, vote for me and I'll take from you. Vote for me in the midst of a pandemic and I'll take health care, even in the midst of all of this death, all of this death. There's something wrong with Trump and Pence. I mean, deep down in the soul, and McConnell and those in the Republicans who have decided to hold on to these positions. It's immoral. It's constitutionally inconsistent. It's economically insane. And it is a form of necropolitics, the politics of death, that is contrary to everything we say we believe in on paper, like life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Reverend Barber, near the end of the debate, Vice President Mike Pence refused to commit to a peaceful transition of power if Biden wins the election. Instead, he commented on Trump administration's legal efforts to restrict mail-in voting.
Let me just say, I think we're going to win this election. President Trump and I are fighting every day in courthouses to prevent Joe Biden and Kamala Harris from changing the rules and creating this universal mail-in voting that will create a massive opportunity for voter fraud. And we have a free and fair election. We know we're going to have confidence in it. And I believe in all my heart that President Donald Trump's going to be reelected for four more years.
So let's talk about the Trump administration's efforts to stop voting and also what you're doing, but the significance of this.
You know, I come from a unique place. North Carolina was the scene of the crime of the worst voter suppression bill after the case out of Alabama. And when the Supreme Court gutted Section 5, and Ruth Bader Ginsburg said that it's like putting away your umbrella, the Shelby case it was, putting away your umbrella in a rainstorm. And in North Carolina, Amy, when it was done, the Republicans there said, now that the problem has been, the headache has been removed, we can do what we want to. And guess what? Everything Pence just said, we heard in 2013. And they tried to roll back every progressive way of voting. And they actually went to the books and looked at how did it benefit black and brown people and young people. And those were the rules they tried to roll back. And the court said it was surgical racism. And what I saw in North Carolina, what we defeated in North Carolina, what we filed suit against in North Carolina, is now what Trump and Pence are talking about doing on the national level, surgical racism with surgical precision. I wish the moderator had drilled down on that voting rights case because, you know, Pence and Trump don't believe in the Voting Rights Act. I mean, Republicans don't believe in restoring even the black one like Tim Scott. They don't believe in it. They know they cannot win if everybody votes. They are terribly afraid of poor and low-wealth black and brown people voting. So what are we doing? We're saying to people, you have to vote. We have a campaign called We Must Do More. And your listeners can go to www.poorpeoplescampaign.org. We've mobilized more than 5,000 persons to make over 1 million calls to poor and low-wealth people in 8 states, where we know the percentage of poor and low-wealth people that need to turn out to change who sits in the Senate, who sits in the presidency, who sits in governor's mansions and general assemblies is under 20%. We are mobilizing all over the country. We are putting out people to do poll watching, and we have a relationship with Forward Justice and the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, creating voting protection so that people know where to call, where they have the legal, what their legal rights are. We're training that. We're mobilizing 1,000 congregations, temples and mosques that are going to organize 1,000 people and their congregations, over 1 million people. We're organizing 10,000 people of faith that we're asking each one of them to reach out to 100 people and to get them to the polls and vote. And we're telling people, vote by absentee ballot. If in North Carolina, where we have 16 days of early voting, vote early. And if you vote on election day, then put your shield on, put your mask on, put your gloves on, pack you a lunch, get you a folding chair, put some water in that lunch bag and vote. And if they want to come watch us vote, let them watch millions of people, because we're not scared. We're not giving away this democracy. Let them come and watch media, and then stop saying Trump won the last time. He was selected by the Electoral College because of 80,000 votes. We have to end this mythology that he had some kind of superpower. The fact of the matter is 100 million people did not vote.
Reverend Barber, at one point during the debate, a fly landed on Pence's head for nearly 2.5 minutes, prompting widespread commentary online. Professor Ibram X. Kendi, author of the best-selling book How to Be an Anti-Racist, tweeted, as soon as Pence started denying the existence of systemic racism, the fly got him. And you have a record last night, a ceiling shattered. Senator Kamala Harris made history as the first black woman to debate a white man in a presidential or vice presidential debate. She was the first black woman, Indian American woman. The significance of this in the last 20 seconds we have.
Yeah, she was fusion politics indeed. She was the second black woman to be the vice president on a major ticket, first on the stage of debate. You know, I couldn't help but go to the book of Exodus, where it talked about where God said, if you don't let my people go, I'm going to cause flies to come as a sign of what's wrong. But I won't let the flies be on the people, but the fly will be a symbol that you're just wrong. You're lying. Let my people go. And Trump and Pence need to let the people go. They've been holding poor and low-wealth people hostage, essential workers hostage. It's time for change in this country.
Reverend Dr. William Barber, co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, we want to thank you so much for being with us, speaking to us from Raleigh, North Carolina.